Hi everyone, my name is Ashton Gleckman, and today I am incredibly grateful and excited to be joined by the one and only David Newman. David Newman has over 100 composing credits to his name. He's conducted orchestras all around the world. He's had his music performed all around the world, has composed the scores for films that I grew up with, from Matilda, Anastasia. He's worked with Danny DeVito on films like Hoffa. He has worked on an incredible range of movies, and most recently he worked with Steven Spielberg on his version of West Side Story, which, as everyone knows, is an Oscar contender this year and is being nominated in a variety of categories. And David was an incredibly integral part of bringing that film together and bringing the music to life, Leonard Bernstein's work, in a completely new but also refreshing and beautiful way. So David, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me today. I really appreciate it.
Sure. I love talking about this. I think it's an amazing movie.
I know now I was right. My first question has to do with the fact that you're part of the Newman family. Your brother's Thomas Newman. He's also a composer like yourself. Your cousin is Randy Newman. Your father is Alfred Newman. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like growing up in such a musical family with so much sort of rich musical history, but also everyone being so interested in music?
Yeah. We grew up in the 60s. I'm 67, so I was born 54. Tom is 55. So we were coming of age during the, Vietnam War protests, and everything was kind of loose. And we grew up in the west side of Los Angeles. We all went to public school. We all played sports and did theater, and of course did music. But it wasn't this really hyped up educational environment that a lot of young people find themselves in now. It was just kind of you just did your thing. You could do lots of different things. I was aware of my father's career, but it really wasn't all that interesting to us. We had our own thing. I was studying violin, and we were trained, of course, which would have been unusual. We were trained very early in these music conservatory things, theory and counterpoint, and a little bit of orchestration, a little bit of formal analysis, basically college courses that if you lived in Europe, you would take when you're 12 years old. But in America, it would be something you do in college when you're 18 or 19. So by the time we are 17, 18, 19, we've been playing in community orchestras, which I think are still a thing, but they were really a thing back then. So a lot of very good amateurs and some professionals played in these community orchestras. So pretty much three or four nights a week, by the time we could play the violin at all, generally it was me and Tom, we're about 18 months apart. So we kind of did everything together. We were playing in orchestra. So by the time we're 14 and 15, we played all the Beethoven symphonies and Tchaikovsky. You know, we'd gone through a lot of the canon. I wouldn't say we certainly weren't prodigies, but we played well enough that we got a sense of what it was. Basically, our upbringing was classical music. There was very little talk of film music, aesthetically what it was, or very little knowledge of how my dad, Alfred Newman, had come to film music and what he had done. Was not a very self-aggrandizing person. It just wasn't in his nature to be. He was kind of self-effacing. I'm not saying he was a wonderful leader and manager. He was great at what he did. I think the acclaim, applause, or whatever you want to call it, that a lot of artists want, he just wasn't all that interested in. He was more interested in the work and stuff. So from what I can tell, I was pretty young when he passed away. He passed away in 1970, so we were, you know, our early teens.
If you're able to reflect now, looking back all these years later, what for you was the biggest lesson that you learned? Obviously, I mean, there's an infinite amount, but what's the biggest thing that your father sort of taught you?
Well, my whole aesthetic comes from my father. I mean, that's a very long conversation. I went to university. I went to USC as an undergrad, a violin major, and worked all through my 20s playing film and television. Worked on lots of John Williams films, lots of Goldsmith films, but basically it was just to make a living. Not that I didn't enjoy movies. I loved movies, like everybody my age. We all loved movies, but I wasn't in any way thinking of being composing as a career. Tom was, but not in film. I mean, he wanted to do musical theater. I wanted to be a conductor. But as I went through college and became more sophisticated as a musician and as a connoisseur of, you know, recordings, and, you know, we all started collecting what were then called LPs, you know, like vinyl, you call it now. I became more sophisticated and I started listening more carefully to the Fox Orchestra, which was the orchestra that my dad spent the most amount of time with at 20th Century Fox. And it just completely flipped me out. Basically, little by little, I thought, nobody can play like this. It's an aesthetic of obsessive phrasing and meaning and knowing where you're going and never, ever coasting, ever. Nobody in the, there is a great tendency in an orchestra to coast, to not keep putting out phrase by phrase by phrase by phrase, because it's so much effort. That was not allowed at Fox. Now, they weren't playing for an hour straight. They weren't playing a Mahler symphony for an hour, which of course is much harder to do that with. They were doing sections. But the phrasing, the string playing in particular, I've never heard anything like it before or since. It's a certain aesthetic of all, it's kind of this hyper rubato style that you kind of think of when you think of old Hollywood golden age film music, you know, of noir films or drama films that Alfred Newman did a lot, but so did, you know, Steiner and the rest of them. That style it came to its height with the Fox Orchestra with Alfred Newman, and it's hyper rubato, and it's always about always knowing, always a phrase going somewhere. A phrase is a group of notes or a theme or a motive that, you know, music moves in time. It moves forward. It moves from A to B to C to D, you know, however you want to grid it. It's always going somewhere, but you'd be surprised how difficult it is to get musicians to agree on where it's going.
So Matilda's strong young mind continued to grow, nurtured by the voices of all those authors who had sent their books out into the world, like ships onto the sea.
When was the first time that, for you specifically, that you began to think about composing music and specifically music for film? When did those things begin to click?
Not till I was in my late 20s. I wanted to be a conductor. I was studying conducting obsessively in my 20s after I graduated, and I was doing film and television work as a violinist. It was interesting, some of it. You know, Goldsmith and John Williams were hegemonic then, so it was amazing when you would do it. You know, I played on E.T., I played on 1941. I played on, Star Trek and a bunch of Goldsmith film, you know. And I just slowly came to the conclusion that I wasn't going to make it as a conductor. Just wasn't in the cards for me. And I didn't want to play violin the rest of my life. So I just made a decision, essentially. I had no calling for it. I just said, you know, I want to make a good living. I probably could learn how to compose. I I believe if you're a trained musician, you can learn to do anything if you know what, you know, if you're trained. So that's what I did. It took me about, I started, I'd say in 1981, kind of drifting in that direction. It took me to about 86, 87 to get started. I had some very lean years. It was very difficult for me. I had a lot of learning to do about it because I hadn't really done it. But I, you know, I eventually figured it out, and then I made my way through. And like everybody, you know, you do as much as you do everything that comes your way, and just cross your fingers and hope you luck out on something. I lucked out with DeVito early on in '87 with Throw Mama from the Train. Just luck. It's just luck. And then the film did really well, and not only did it do really well, people in Hollywood loved the movie. They loved the style of the movie, and so. A lot of it is, as much of it as that, does the industry like the movie?
I've always been curious, because I'm really interested in composer-director relationships, whether it's Nolan and Zimmer, whether it's John Williams and Spielberg, or whether it's you and DeVito. I'm curious, is it sort of astounding to you every time you do another movie and you're like, wow, we're still together, we're still doing this? Like, what's it like doing multiple projects with the same person?
Unfortunately, he's not directing anymore. There's a reason that you hook up with somebody, basically. There's a simpatico. I was a born again opera freak. I hated opera until college. And then I was born again. I couldn't get enough. And DeVito is very Italian sensibility, and his films are very lush and rich and operatic and weird. And I found I was good at dark comedy. When you have a relationship like that, you both learn from each other a little bit. You push each other. Danny's not, he's not much of a talker. I mean, he is a talker, but it's more like he'll almost act out scenes for you for like what he wants. It's not like do this or do that. And a lot of it's nonverbal. Yeah, and most profoundly with Spielberg and John Williams. And since that spans so long, I think that's sort of a litmus test for what a relationship like that can spawn. You know, that John had really taught Steven Spielberg a lot. And obviously Spielberg taught John Williams a lot.
What's it been like for you to sort of witness the evolution of music, specifically since the studio era, since the days of your father, the days of the Gone with the Wind, big, you know, regal, beautiful classic scores, to now? It's changed a lot. But has the form of music within media, within films, changed from your perspective?
It's changed recently. I think it went through a process in the 60s. I mean, it's fairly easy to grid, you know, they started in the 30s, 1930. There was no talking film industry till 1930. Korngold came in 1934. And as you said, by 1939, there's Gone with the Wind, Wuthering Heights, Wizard of Oz. I mean, but 1939 sounds like a film score. And then that just basically with, you know, one of, you know, you have Bernard Herrmann, you have Korngold in the mix, you have Tiomkin, you know, here and there, you've got your newcomers, you've got, you know, Alex North coming, David Raxon, Bernard Herrmann, it changes a little bit, but it's basically that. And then you get to the break of the studio system, and then you've got Mancini, and you've got very small scores, like all a lot of the John Williams scores in the 60s are kind of, you know, they're like harpsichordy, or they're the big ones, but it's much smaller. And then of course there's Jaws and Star Wars.
I'm really curious from your perspective as well. Clearly, I mean, we've seen, let's just talk about Steven Spielberg and John Williams, or Steven Spielberg and Alan Silvestri on Ready Player One, Steven still trusts thematic writing. He still trusts thematic writing, which a lot of directors don't nowadays.
Yeah.
So I'm curious for you, how do we, not necessarily revive, how do we maintain that amazing tradition of thematic writing?
Movies demand what they demand. Even when it's not just the directors, it's hard to understand. When we do what we do with film composing, it's trifurcated. You know, there's pre-production of a film, there's shooting, and there's post-production. Music is in post-production. So we watch the film being edited. So in the post-production, the first thing they do is they do a director's cut. They just put everything in, everything they shot, they put in. It's hours and hours. The director's cut of Hoffa was 4.5 hours. Obviously, the movie's not going to be 4.5 hours, right?
Yeah.
And you watch them as the composer edit it. Pretty soon, the movie starts to come alive. And by alive, I mean, it starts to show what it is, what it needs. And it starts to be more like what a good director would do is, instead of trying to make the movie, it's like the Michelangelo looking at a piece of marble and saying what he is doing is stripping away. He can see what's in the statue because he realizes that thing is almost sentient, living in that stone. I mean, it's a crazy, weird metaphor, but that really is what, if you watch this over and over, this process, and you can watch them completely F it up too. A director that is crazy and can't stop, you know, doing this and that, you'll see a cut, then you'll see another cut and it's worse. Then you see another cut. So instead of getting better, it's getting worse. It's getting less clear. It's letting less emotive and all that. But you know, somebody like Spielberg, these guys that are way at the top of their game, they get this. So that eventually the film demands what it needs. And that's where, and since music, we're at the end of it, we have to contend with that, you know? And so if you're correct that thematic, which is, it's essentially a Wagnerian construct of leitmotives, except that the music isn't Germanic sounding, it's kind of Italianate, it's very tuneful and pretty and fun. If the movies needed that and it worked, it would probably still be going, is my point. My point is it's not necessarily a decision that they just make. It just doesn't work. You put it up there and the theme, it seems too conventional, or I don't know what it is. I would posit that it's not going to come back the way that it was. The heart and soul of Star Wars is the Force theme. It just is. I mean, and the whole heart and soul of that franchise is the Force, a secular religion, essentially. That theme, which is different than any of the other Star Wars themes, is the heart and soul of it, because you hear it more than once and it's developed and it pieces of it are taken into, you know, that's historically what's been done. That's not happening now.
I think one of the most extraordinary things about West Side Story is that it is an experience designed for the big screen, whether it's Adam Stockhausen's production design, whether it's Kaminsky's cinematography. When you watch the film in a cinema, in an IMAX, I mean, especially, you can see the beauty behind it.
Tonight, tonight, the world is full of light.
This is my first time in New York City. I want to be happy here. I want to make a life, a home.
Are you ready?
Tonight is about family.
The first gringo boy who smiles at you.
I never seen you before. You're not Puerto Rican.
Is that okay?
Do you want to start World War III?
It must have been a joy to work on. Let's sort of dive into West Side Story. So first and foremost, a little bit about how you got involved with the film. How did it come to you? I know it was through your friend John Williams.
Yeah, it was through John Williams. He was supposed to do it. I'm very intimately familiar with West Side Story, and I know where to grab the stuff to do. So that's basically, I was there to, with the Bernstein estate, the people running his estate, particularly Garth Sunderland, know where to pull all the stuff from. You know, we did a lot more of the Broadway orchestrations, you know, which, you know, I had to stitch things in and out and do, you know, various things, but really it had nothing to do with re-upping it or rearranging it. It was again, you probably heard me say, for me, it's the metaphor of an opera production. The music's the same, the lyrics are essentially the same, or if they're different, Sondheim was there to supervise everything, which he did the whole project. And the production's different, so there's a little bit of a different script, but it certainly does not seem not like West Side Story. That was the idea. What we wanted it to be, it's basically a remake of a remake, but it's not a remake at all. It's just a different production.
One of the things that I love about it is, if you were alive when the 57 version came out and the 61 version came out, when you watch the prologue to Steven Spielberg's version, it brings back so much nostalgia. But if you haven't seen the original, if you're coming to it for the first time, it opens up this entirely new world that is just totally timeless. I mean, it could have been written yesterday. For you, what is the essence of why that original score by Leonard Bernstein is so timeless? What for you?
It is timeless. That's a way to put it. I would say it is in the classical music canon. Meaning, I was talking about Beethoven and Mozart and all the stuff that you play when you're a kid. It's in that canon. So the canon is what orchestras around the world play over and over and over again. There are tiers of the canon. You know, you've got your Beethoven, Mozart, and then Mahler, you know, second tier, third tier. But anything that's in the canon, and certainly anything that is American that is in the canon, that's even more rare. And anything from Broadway is, there isn't another example of it. The Bernstein symphonic dances that he did in 1961 that he arranged is in the classical music canon. So that must be one in a million, if not more, the odds of that happening. So it is in fact timeless, and it is in fact very dangerous to mess around with it. So we were very, very, very careful to give Spielberg what he needed, you know, this many bars, that he needs a underscore cue, he needs this, he needs, you know, whatever it is that he needs, without anyone knowing that we did anything. I would have preferred no one did any arranging, orchestrating, or anything on it at all. So we tried to always find something somewhere that Bernstein had wrote and orchestrated. So there's very little of it in there are little like stitching here and there to do things. There are a couple of underscore cues that are a little bit of stitching. The arrangement for Somewhere is different. That's the one thing that I did. Along with a few other people. But that we felt is so weird, because in the show, it's sung by an offstage opera singer in the Broadway show. And then in the movie, it's Tony and Maria singing. So it's completely different in the movie. So we felt like that's as far off as we could go, was that.
Right. So when it comes to West Side Story, we're looking at this completely new production. It is a completely new production. I think it's important to note this is not a remake of the 61 movie. This is a totally new rendition that's pretty much created from the bottom up by the team involved.
Right.
What about Steven Spielberg made him so right for this project? Because, of course, when you're coming into it, any filmmaker can't tackle this. Yeah. So what was it about his intuition?
In retrospect, you know, I told you I played on E.T. And then the movie that John did after E.T. was called 1941. Have you ever seen that movie?
I have.
Yeah. So you remember the big jitterbug sequence in that?
Yeah. Yep.
Go back and look at it again, and you can see why he's the right person to do it. It's brilliant. I think it's a 5 or 6 minute sequence where Treat Williams is chasing that girl around in this jitterbug club or the USO thing. And the way it's shot is the way this, like, you can see how musically it's shot. So like in West Side Story, you mentioned the cinematographer.
Kaminsky.
Janosch. Every camera move is phrased in West Side Story. If you watch it again, just watch how it's phrased. So everything, Spielberg understood that everything was about the music, which is why we needed to have the music be, as you said, timeless.
There's something due any day, I will know right away, soon as it shows. It may come cannonballing down through the sky, gleaming its eye, bright as a rose. Who knows?
We didn't want the music to bump anyone out of the 61 film or anyone that had seen the Broadway film, seen the Broadway show, the few people in the world that have seen it, because most people have seen the 61 movie. That it just is a much better recording of West Side Story with different singers, younger singers, you know, et cetera, a little bit different here and there. And the camera moving just helps that with the music, the whole sound design, also same thing. There's an example in the quintet when the 5-part harmony.
The rumble, yeah.
Right before the rumble, every time a new group starts singing, there's a big sound effect. It's boom, you know, boom, each time. And then they all sing together.
They're gonna get it tonight. No more, they turn it on the heart of the ball. Will they be getting
it? It's just, and the beginning of the film, that the way the sound is and it cranes in and they're just crushed. It's demolished. Their world is just, like, over, and they're young and they're trying to be alive and stay alive, and you understand why you would be a jet and what's going on with the shark. You just instantly understand it with the sound.
Right.
He's just so good at it. They're so good at dubbing. That's why seeing it in a theater, it's one of the best dub, if not the best dub movies I've ever seen.
It
but
is.
Spielberg's always great with dubbing.
Yeah, and I also love one of the things that Jeanine Tesori, and for those who don't know her, she was basically responsible for all of the incredible vocal performances across the board in this movie. But one of the things she said is that when she brought the actors in, she didn't want to make it a legacy piece. She didn't want to keep pressing on them that, hey, you're doing something really important. Yeah. She wanted it to be fresh for all those performances. So what for you was the secret to, of course, we have to maintain that complete and utter devotion to the original Bernstein score, but we also have to adapt it for this new film version. How do you navigate that?
They cast different younger singers, which is a great idea. I think, arguably, if you were going to criticize the 61 film, that, you know, you have your makeup issues and they're a little bit old, I think, for the part. You know, even Broadway, they're a little, if you had your druthers, you know, the younger they are, the better it works. It works better to fall in to watch a very, very young person fall in love instantly than it is somebody older. It's more realistic in human nature. So the voices are the voices, but we were responsible not for how they sung it. Well, of course we were, but Jeanine, you know, but we were responsible for what they were singing, the music that they were singing, and then the lyrics that Sondheim and Kushner and Steven, you know, worked on, the few changes that they made, which they didn't do a lot of changes, but they did some, you know. And so that's fine. The different voices, different characters, nobody's going to be upset. That's not going to upset the apple cart. As a matter of fact, the casting really helped the movie. I think Ansel being really tall and Rachel short.
You're tall.
Yeah, I know. You're not.
Spielberg used really well. They shot it really well. You know, they used what they had to tell the story. It's just like, it's like a production of Traviata or Butterfly. You know, you've got the music, you've got the lyrics, then you've got your who you cast in it, and you work with who you're casting to tell the story, but you don't sing different music and you don't say different words, but you can do, it's okay to do something different. It's sort of the whole Western tradition of what it is, but it doesn't make it not Madame Butterfly or not La Boheme. You wouldn't say, oh, this is an update of La Boheme. I mean, unless you're doing like, you know, what, you know, Rent. Unless you really are, yeah, like Rent, yeah. Or something, then it is. But yeah. that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a production of West Side Story, not remaking West Side Story. Though there is an element, you know, this is from my point of view. I don't know what, I've never heard Kushner talk about it. But I know they were very, very, very careful about what they did and the choices that they made.
Yeah. Well, I mean, when you listen to the cast and especially Steven talk about the film, they really press upon the importance of Tony Kushner's script.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Tony Kushner is the person responsible for bringing this into the modern contemporary
yeah.
world.
Yes.
I am curious, from the perspective of movie musicals, there's been a lot in recent years, whether it's Les Mis, whether it's Sweeney Todd, and in every single case, there has to be slight, not alterations to the music, but conforms to it in order to match the changes that happen when you make a movie, when you make... So for you, I know one of the things you talked about is that you aren't changing the music. You're just adapting motifs and filling in areas that need to be filled in.
Mm-hmm. I go and look for it. It's either in the movie score. It's in the Broadway. Mostly we found stuff in the Broadway. There's a lot of music in the Broadway show that's not in the 61 movie. And we have the symphonic dances, which we used. And so, you know, there... And then when there was nothing to find, the few cases that there was, I did it. And believe me, it had to go through Spielberg and Bernstein. I mean, it wasn't to do the tiny little bits that I did. It went through a process. It was not, if it didn't sound like Bernstein in any way, one note, right? One note would be no.
Make of our hands one hand, make of our hearts one heart, make of our vows one last vow, even death won't part.
Yeah, just keep going back and doing that. That I'm used to. That's what film composing is. As we were talking about, I mocked it up, inserted it where it needed to be. You know, we need 8 bars here. We need 16 bars in America, you know, or what are we going to do? Or in Cool, we need to take out a beat here and there. So what do we do? And the arrangement of Somewhere, which was a different animal. That was the only thing in the movie like that, that was really completely different. And it wasn't even completely different, because the middle section of it is from the Broadway orchestration. But the a cappella nature of it in the beginning with solo piano, all that was new.
Now, I'm super fascinated in how movies are made. So I bought the West Side Story behind the scenes book, yeah. And I've watched all the behind the scenes footage of it. You were there. You saw the movie sort of in development. Can you talk about what it was like witnessing the movie sort of come to life over those many months that all these different departments were...
Well, It was pretty bifurcated the departments pretty much kind of kept to themselves. I mean, we were working on mostly the music stuff. We were at a lot of the rehearsals. I did a lot of the pre-recording, conducting, but we were our little music team. Now Janine was more involved with casting and stuff because she works with Tony. So Janine was involved way early on, but once we got to the pre-recording process, and then Janine was there during the shooting, and then she wasn't there very much for post, but the rest of us, the music editor and Matt and all that team, we were,
you know, we were there. And then we re-recorded everything with Gustavo and the New York Philharmonic post-recording, you know. So it honestly, and we got waylaid by COVID. I mean, it came out a whole year later than it was supposed to, than we had planned because of COVID. And it was very difficult to finish the movie because of COVID. That's why we had to stay in Los Angeles to finish the movie. But it was so on and off and everything. It wasn't until I saw the final, you know, we went and mixed the music and all that, but it wasn't until I saw the final film that I really knew what it was. I mean, for real, for from beginning to end, you know, it's not a short film. And so watching it from beginning to end, really listening to the dub, having some objectivity, having some time off, because it would get pretty all consuming. What you say?
Today, all day, I had the feeling a miracle would happen. I know now I was right.
So I don't know that I really have a good 50,000 foot view of how it all came together. Plus, Spielberg has an unusual way of working. He doesn't like everyone sharing stuff. It's more of it's more of a slow drip that you get stuff that you're working on. It's not, I've never worked with anybody like that, but it's obviously, I just think it's a miraculous movie. I know West Side Story, I've music directed, I've played in it. I done the live 61 movie with orchestra 40, 50 times. I just thought it was just miraculous when I saw it. I couldn't believe
yeah.
it.
Yeah, and I think what's really interesting is that, I mean, at least me, someone who's seen the film a few times, who's read everything about it, just the amount of joy everyone seemed to be having yeah. making the movie, the yeah. joy yeah. making the movie. And that's what yeah. movies should always be about.
Yeah.
You know, I wake up to everything I know either getting sold or wrecked or being taken over by people that I don't like.
You keep away from him as long as you're in my house.
I'm a grown up now, Bernardo. I'm gonna think for myself.
Tony, we need you if we're going to war.
To me, it's like when we were, I've said this before, but in the west side of Los Angeles, I don't know, where are you from?
Indianapolis.
Okay. So I don't know if musical theater, well, you're so young now, so I don't know if musical theater was a big thing in school for you guys. But for us and my brother, it was the thing. We were in a public high school in west side of Los Angeles where basically all the film people lived, you know, late 60s. And the film, the entire spring semester from every day from about 2:30 or 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. was spent rehearsing whatever the spring musical was going to be, right? And one year it was West Side Story when we were in 11th grade. And the joy with which the 200 or 300 kids that were involved in all various aspects of it, the joy and love that everyone had, obviously nobody's doing it except because they love it. That's what he managed to bring to this. It's like everybody had a West Side Story in their youth and loved it. No one was trying to insert themselves, all of the Mozart thing I was talking about. In a way, you brought your A game into this thing without trying to make it individually yours, your thing. You wanted to bring into Bernstein and West Side Story the best of your ability to make it the best that it could possibly be. And I think across the board, across the age range that was involved, the you know, the elder statesman all the way down to Rachel, you know, the Maria.
It She's just 18 was like a big, making that
right,
movie.
Right, right, right. To me, it was like what the best thing is, like a high school, is I had the feeling of a high school musical that just everyone would have stayed a whole nother year shooting and working on it and doing it and performing it, and you know, nobody wanted it to end, I'm sure.
Can you talk about what Gustavo Dudamel brought to the movie, into this?
Yeah,
score?
It's great. He came, he did a little bit of the pre-recording and came at the end, and it's the best performance is you know, it's New York Philharmonic, it's Bernstein's orchestra. It was all the right stuff, you know. That's the one thing, is we had money for all that. for Dudamel and for New York Philharmonic. And I'm sorry it didn't make back most of its money, but I'm sure with the streaming, however the hell that gets monetized, again, to our point, I have no idea how one individual makes money or doesn't make money, but it was all the best of the best, basically. I was honored to be involved in the whole thing, quite frankly. So it wasn't easy, and it's not a job I would want to do on any other film like this, because I'm just so intimately aware of West Side Story and all, and I've seen so many of the Broadway productions and I've done so much of the movie, and I did an arrangement for the violinist Sarah Chang that she plays. It's been around for a lot for me. So it was a sort of one-off thing for me, but when I saw it, and then the premieres were just joyful.
Talking about the film, I would love your thoughts about the performers, the actors, Rachel, Ariana, David, Mike. What do you think they brought to the movie?
It was all perfect. The casting, Mike, the riff thing, he was just a revelation. Rachel, they all were.
The Jets. My guys. My guys who are just like me. Who are just like you.
I thought Justin Peck's choreography was great. It doesn't look all that different than Jerome Robbins, does it? I mean, it's a little different. It's more muscular. It's a little more tailored towards the actors, which is it should be. But it's not like some weird, completely, you wouldn't look at that and say, that's not Jerome Robbins. That's not Jerome Robbins, you know, they had to get permission. You cannot do, in order to do the show without that Jerome Robbins choreography, you have to go through a big thing to get permission to do that. You know, it's not an easy thing to do. So I thought what he did, again, it was in the spirit of the whole thing. He's honoring Jerome Robbins, who's a hero of his. It's, Jerome Robbins is his New York City Ballet kind of predecessor hero, Justin Peck, which he has said in interviews. He also wrote, there's a really great article that I tweeted out or I retweeted that with him talking about it. I don't know if you read it, which described pretty well what I was talking about with the music, what he described with the choreography. And I just thought everyone across the board was brilliant. I thought it was a brilliant choice to have Rita be Doc's widow. I thought
her performance, wow.
Tony, you don't have enough troubles.
I don't want to jinx it, but maybe I'm done with trouble.
Oh, you are never done with troubles. Nunca.
And it all seemed like West Side Story. It did. Nothing seemed like this isn't West Side Story. That was sort of our mantra. Is this what, if I did something, if we did something in the music, it just, this doesn't sound like West Side Story. Well, okay, this is why. But you can immediately tell it doesn't sound like West Side Story.
And what were your thoughts, and this obviously is something that helped the story, is rearranging some of the songs. For example, Cool Now comes before the Rumble rather than after it, which adds to the tension.
Precedence in the movie. The movie moved stuff around. Also, Sondheim always wanted America to be the guys and the girls. And in the Broadway show, it's just the girls. In the 61 movie, it's the boys and girls. And like he didn't like I Feel Pretty, and I think the way Kushner designed I Feel Pretty, now Sondheim really liked it now, and he thought that the lyric was too sophisticated for Maria, but and now she's working at, where is it, Gimbel she's working at, or
I Feel Pretty, Gimbel's,
so Gimbel's is a pretty upper echelon store, so the little sophisticated rhymes and everything make more sense. And the way Rachel did that's just the best I Feel Pretty ever. And plus, you can't take I Feel Pretty out. Those of us with the music, it doesn't matter where you put it. It has to be after the Rumble.
Like dancing for joy, for a love. I am pretty, wonderful boy.
you have to let some air out of the balloon after the rumble.
And it's oddly tragic because she doesn't know that the person she's singing about.
And,
yeah.
Right. And immediately after that, Chino tells her, and that's the end of the movie. Basically, once Chino tells her that Tony's, you know, that Tony killed, you know, the whole story, basically you're the last quarter of the movie. It's over. You know, it's very front heavy. The Broadway show had a structural problem, which is why they put that ballet in, because it was just too short. After the rumble, there's one scene when Maria doesn't know, and then she knows, and then it's all, you know, balls to the wall to the end, you know, when he gets killed. So, you know, one thing we did do, which what I loved, we tried to get, I don't know how familiar you are with the Broadway show, with the ballet and the Broadway show.
Right, you so, put that in the sequence before America. Yeah.
Garth got it. We always, Garth and I, the Bernstein person who I work with, we were determined to get at least the scherzo in the movie somewhere, even if it was just in the end title. But Garth convinced Spielberg to make a scene out of it. And he made this iconic scene. What we started with was which is the ballet's in five parts. We started with what's called the intro into the scherzo. So there was all that kind of dissonant music as New York wakes up, and then the camera pans into her room, and the music changes. And then she gets up, and for some reason, she's still in her dress, her white.
Right, so she's.
So why is she in her, you know, that's not in the movie or in the show. But again, that just seems so West Side Story.
Yeah.
And it's all choreographed, as you notice.
What is the piece of music that you feel most connected to in this movie, and why?
Oh, that is impossible to answer. I love the prologue. I love the way the prologue develops and the sense of joy and anger and violence in it. I love the end of the quintet, or what we call the Tonight Quintet, the thing before the rumble. And I love I love the way he did the ending with the ending with the symphonic dances, which is what we used at the ending. But that wasn't really in the 61 film or the I don't know. It's very hard for me to parse which one I love more than the. I love certain, but like the end of Tonight, that when they go good night, I think is gorgeous.
Sleep well, and when you dream.
I think the whole thing is gorgeous. Really.
What was the biggest thing that you took away from the experience of working with Steven, working with this incredible team on this movie?
It was miraculous to me. A movie could be made like this. This is a real, you know what it felt like? It felt like a swan song.
If you go with him, no one will ever forgive you.
I felt like this is the last movie I'm ever going to see. I felt kind of sad about it in a way, but I'm so happy I got to see it in a theater. I've hardly been to a theater at all in the last 4 or 5 years. And generally when we've gone, my wife loves Bond movies and Marvel movies. I'm not as much a fan as she is, but this was like, holy moly. It was just so lovely. It just was so interesting watching West Side Story from this point of view when I'd seen it so many times. It just seemed completely natural and right and inevitable, everything that happened, you know?
For my last question, I want to talk just a little bit about the legacy of this musical, and specifically Leonard Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim, who we lost recently. What is the biggest lesson we can learn from how extraordinary of a life this musical has had?
West Side Story is a weird thing because there was never really anything like it. Even Candide and On the Town were not like this. This is something unusual and special, and it really didn't spawn anything. There's been nothing like it since. You've got opera, you've got vaudeville, Pattersong, you've got jazz, you've got Latin late 50s jazz. You have a fugue in the middle of a dance number, a Baroque procedure with a subject and a counter subject. You have five-part Renaissance polyphony, essentially, which is what the quintet is. It's very much a Renaissance madrigal-ish. It's not really a madrigal, but it's a Renaissance polyphony type of piece. I mean, you're talking about 7, 8, 9 different styles mushed together that all sound like Bernstein and West Side Story. And I don't think he ever managed to do that successfully again. So I think it's therefore a unique piece. I mean, it's certainly in the canon of musical theater, which doesn't, you know, isn't as old as Western canonical classical music. But as I said, even more miraculously, it's in the classical music canon. I cannot stress enough how difficult that is. If you think of all the music written since, say, about 1750, Haydn, and then Mozart, 1780, and then Beethoven, 1800s, and on and on and on to present day, of pieces that are played every year, and that you can't think of any reason they would ever not be played every year, it's one in a million. And I think West Side Story belongs in both those genres there. And it just is timeless.
One of those beautiful things is just the fact that when you listen to the cast, like on their press tour, they've been giving a lot of recognition to the technical team that was involved in this movie, which is something you don't always get. And the fact that everyone has been talking about Paul Tazewell's costumes and Stockhausen's production design, it's amazing. It's such a testament to teamwork. To you, thank you so much for your incredible work on this and for doing this today. I really appreciate it.
Very, very good interview. You asked very good questions. I appreciate it. See ya. Mm-hmm.